Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. This is my sisters and brothers in Christ. This is our worship service, the time that we've set aside to come together and worship God. We worship God, my sisters and brothers in Christ, in spirit and in truth. We worship not at a particular location, but we worship God wherever we find ourselves. We've chosen to come to this place this morning to worship God. This is the 17th Sunday after Pentecost. And I believe this bears repeating. I'll say it again and again and again. The church is the most powerful organization on the face of the planet. We received the promise of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. When the Spirit came to empower the church. And so we, my sisters and brothers in Christ, have the Holy Spirit, as the Bible says, as the seal and guarantee of our salvation. Grace and peace to you from the Lord Jesus Christ and God our Father and the Holy Spirit. I have a couple of announcements that are in order that are not printed in your bulletin. I'd like to highlight them. One is our Ministry of the Month. Our Ministry of the Month for this particular month, for the month of September, is a free wheelchair missions. And so you can go online and link up with that organization. You can donate to them, or you can go online if you are in need or know someone who may be in need of a wheelchair. Their mission is to provide wheelchairs for the whosoever will, whosoever needs one. And you can find that ministry at freewheelchairmissions.org, freewheelchairmissions.org. Also, we are engaged in our Bible conversation. Our Bible conversation, my sisters and brothers in Christ, is where we are simply having Bible study. And we want to invite you to come and be part of that. In our weekly blast or in our weekly trumpet, you may find a link to link up with us, no pun intended, to link up with us and come be a part of our Bible conversation. We're literally talking about prayer. Teach Me to Pray is the name of the book, and you can come and join right in. We all need to learn how to pray effectively. James says this in his word, the effective, fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. And we'll talk about that next week. My last thing that I have for you in way of announcements is the scripture for next week. Next week, my sisters and brothers in Christ will be looking, want you to get ahead of the game. We'll be looking at James chapter 5 and verses 13 through 20. And we'll be talking about prayer. Amen? Amen. Join with me in our call to worship. Our call to worship is printed in your bulletin, in your order of worship. And it comes from Psalms 1 and verses 1 through 6. Here is what the psalm writer says for us today. Blessed is the one who does not walk in the steps with the wicked, or stand in the way that the sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaves does not wither. Whatever they do, they prosper. Not so with the wicked. They are like the chaff the wind blows away. Therefore, the wicked will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the assembly of the righteous. For the Lord watches over the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked leads to destruction. Our opening hymn of praise, my sisters and brothers in Christ, is hymn number 397, I Need Thee Every Hour. But let us go to God in prayer. Let us go to God, and then we'll hear from our musician. Gracious God, to you belongs glory, dominion, power, now and forevermore. To you we give praise. This is the day that you have made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Father, we invite your Spirit this morning into this place. We invite your Spirit to come and unite our hearts and our minds together that we might be on one accord, that we might praise you, that our praises might come up to you, and that they might permeate your nostrils as a sweet smell and aroma. Lord, have your way in this place. Have your way in each of our lives. Move us this morning, God, to a place where we feel uncomfortable, to the place where we can worship you without hesitation or reservation, to a place where we can worship you in spirit and in truth. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and give you glory for this time-space continuum that you've placed us in. Move in our lives today. Move in such a way that you might be glorified. This is our prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. I need thee every hour. Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. I need thee every hour. Our time with our young people has become special to me. I love talking with young people. I have, if you don't know this, I have five grandchildren, and they range from age 6 to 2 years old. And so I enjoy having conversation with them. It's always fun to hear their response. I have one grandson who calls me Papa. He's 4 and a half, and he is just like, Papa, why do frogs jump? Papa, why is the sky blue? I don't know. I wish I did, but I don't know. And so it's fun. But here is a message that I have for you all that I love this particular message. It comes from James's letter. And we've been talking about James for the last couple weeks, and I promise you this is not a sermon series, but I want to talk to you this morning about wisdom from above. And so your lesson comes from James chapter 3 and verse 17 and chapter 4 and verses 7 and 8. And again, this comes from the New International Reader's Version of the Bible, which is a great version. I love the way it reads. But this is what James writes in verse 17. But the wisdom that comes from heaven is pure. That's the most important thing about it. And that's not all. It also loves peace. It thinks about others. It obeys. It is full of mercy and good fruit. It is fair. It does not pretend to be what it's not. In verse 7 of chapter 4, verses 7 and 8, he writes this. So obey God. Stand up to the devil. He will run away from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and make your heart pure, you who can't make up your mind. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Wisdom from above. How do you tell when someone is wise? Can anyone share with me how you tell when someone is wise? Wisdom is a word that the church uses a lot of times. I've heard the word wisdom almost every Sunday I've been in a church, and that's been a long time. Wisdom is the understanding that comes from God, the understanding that comes from reading God's word. It's wise thinking. There are many people in the Bible who are called wise. Can you name anyone? I'll name some for you. There was King David. He was called wise. There was his son Solomon, who was known as the wisest guy on the planet. There was Joseph and Mary. There was Sarah and Deborah. There was Rebecca and Hannah. There was Elizabeth. And of course, we all know there was Jesus. These are some, just a few of the folk that the Bible says that are wise. How wise are you? Are you really wise? Are you applying God's word into your everyday lives? Wisdom cannot be measured, and it is even harder to tell when someone is wise. You can't take a test to tell if you're wise. Some people might think you can, but you can't. Wisdom is something, my young brothers and sisters in Christ, that you get over time by being intentional about reading and studying and applying God's word. It comes from, directly from studying God's word. The older we get, the wiser we should be, you would think, and sometimes it's difficult to see that. But James reminds us that our lives are to be transformed by God's word. Our hearts are to be full of love, and we ought to become wiser. But James also reminds us that if we don't make our hearts pure in love with God, that's a problem. Do you remember our character that we talked about a while ago in the board game Operation? Cavity Sam. Remember Cavity Sam? Cavity Sam had one problem after another. One of the biggest problems that Cavity Sam had was his heart was broken. His heart was broken. And I don't know if Sam had a heart that was in a right relationship with God, but that's my concern about us. We have to make sure that our hearts are in tune with God. We have to make sure that we're in love with God. We have to make sure that we're reading God's word, because the wisdom from above comes from God. I don't want us to feel the way that I kind of think that Cavity Sam was feeling, with a broken heart, disconnected. James reminds us that when we follow Christ, we can grow and we can live wise lives for the rest of our lives. James reminds us that wisdom from above comes from God. Can you remember that? Can you say it with me? Wisdom from above comes from God. Let us pray. God of wisdom, God of love, God of justice, God of peace, come into our hearts and change our lives. Change us for the better, that we might love more, that we might grow more in wisdom, that we might be full of peace. We love you, we praise you, and give you glory. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you will join with me, my sisters and brothers in Christ, God's divine word comes from the book of James, comes from James's letter to the church and the church that is abroad. And he says that this is written to the churches that are scattered. It comes from the third chapter in verses 13 through 18 and chapter 4, verses 1 through 4 and verses 7 and 8. And this is what James writes for us this morning. Who is wise and understanding among you? Let them show it by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not boast about it or deny the truth. Such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but is earthly, unspiritual, and demonic. For where you have envy and selfish ambition, there you will find disorder and envy, every evil practice. But wisdom that comes from heaven is first of all pure, then peace-loving, considerate, submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere, peacemakers who sow in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. Chapter 4, verse 1 says this, what causes fights and quarrels among you? Do they not come from your desire that you battle within? You desire, but do not have. So you kill. You covet, but do not get what you want. So you quarrel and fight. You do not have because you do not ask God. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasure. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let's pray, my sisters and brothers in Christ. Gracious God, thank you for your word both written and for your living word in Jesus Christ. Bless our time together now. Open our hearts and our minds that we might be able to see what your word says for each of our lives and help us to live it out, to live in such a way that someone might know that we are wise in Christ and not on our own. This is our prayer in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. We're going to hear from our musician and the favorite song that I believe that is going to be played, is going to be shared with us. It's one of my all-time favorite, Just a Closer Walk with Thee. Amen. It's found in the Faith We Sang. It's printed in your order of worship, page number 2158. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Amen, amen. I just love that song. That is beautiful. Just a closer walk with thee. Wisdom from above. How is our conduct? How are we living? How is our behavior? Those are questions. If someone was to follow us around for a day or two or three or a week with a camera or a recorder, what would they capture? Would they see someone who was kind and generous and always peace-loving, always doing what was right, always doing the right thing? Would they find someone moving the goalposts or moving the goal line, moving things to where they would be more in my favor or more in our favor or to gain the upper hand? Character, someone has declared, is our conduct when no one is watching, the way we act when no one is around us. That is character. I would say, my sisters and brothers, that is godly living. That is godly wisdom. Godly wisdom is to be displayed in each of our lives. It is to be displayed in our daily lives as we move forward. As people of God, as Christians, we understand that God calls us to live a specific way. God calls us to live different lives than the world around us. Wisdom cannot be measured. It cannot take a test to find out how wise we are. Wisdom, my sisters and brothers, is something that we gain slowly as we are intentional about living God's word out in our lives. In James' exhortation today, my sisters and brothers in Christ, he encourages us through his teachings on wisdom. The definition that we find about wisdom is skilled in managing affairs, the knowledge and practice of godly living, or the knowledge and practice of upright living. Now, we find this section of James that he uses a lot of exaggeration here. He uses the language that was good for his day to give people the importance of what he was instructing, what he was teaching. He says this in verse 1 of chapter 4. He says, you war and fight against yourself. And he says, you kill. And then he even says, you adulterous generation. And he uses that language to bring attention to the importance of what he's saying. It's the same language that many of the Old Testament writers used when they wanted to drive home the point, when they wanted the reader to really grasp what they were saying, when they wanted the listener to really grasp what he's saying. And I love exaggeration in James's word. If we recall, my sisters and brothers in Christ, James has spoken about wisdom. In chapter 1 and verse 5 through 7, he says this, if anyone lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives graciously and without finding fault. Other versions say he gives wisdom without reproach. In other words, God won't slap us on the hand and say, didn't I tell you that last week? Or didn't I tell you that yesterday? Or didn't I tell you that 2 years ago? No, James says God will give us wisdom if we ask God, and he'll give it to us graciously. He'll give it to us over and over and over again. He'll give it to us time after time, provided we ask for wisdom. But he also warns us about this. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt. Because the one who doubts is like the waves of the sea, blown and tossed by the wind. That person should not expect to receive anything from the Lord. Such a person is double-minded and unstable in all that they do. He spoke about this, taming the tongue. Taming the tongue is displayed in wisdom. Taming the tongue is displayed in the way that we conduct ourselves. In verse 13 of chapter 3, James writes this, who is wise and understanding among you? It's a question. And then he says, let it be shown by their good life, by deeds done in humility that comes from wisdom. Wisdom, my sisters and brothers in Christ, as James is displaying it to us, wisdom, the way that James is teaching it to us, is not some philosophical theory that you cannot touch. Wisdom, my sisters and brothers in Christ, according to James, ought to be displayed in and through our lives. Wisdom, my sisters and brothers in Christ, is to show up in our everyday lives. I said this in the past, and I believe it bears repeating. Our belief dictates our behavior. What we believe in is demonstrated in the way that we live as Christians. In verse 14, he says, "But if you harbor bitter envy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast about it or deny the truth." In other words, James says here, this whole idea of bitter envy or having ill will or selfish ambition means that you're doing stuff for your own gain or you have some sort of a fraud going on in your life. And I found that interesting. But he says, if that is what's going on in your life, you ought not boast about it. You ought not brag about, hey, this is what's going on in my life, because that's not wisdom. Do not boast about it or deny the truth. In other words, if we got bitter envy and selfish ambition, we ought not be bragging about that stuff as believers in Christ. Here is the way 1 John 1:6 puts it. If we claim to have fellowship with him, with God, and you walk in darkness, we lie and do not live in the truth. But if we walk in the light with him as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, has purified us from all sin. James says again in verse 15, such wisdom that bitter envy and selfish ambition, such wisdom does not come down from heaven, but it's earthly. It's unspiritual and demonic. So there are two types of wisdom that he's dealing with. One comes from the earth realm, and the other comes from the heavenly realm. And James says the wisdom that we see operating in our lives with bitter envy and selfish ambitions, that wisdom is earthly wisdom, and there is something wrong with it, my sisters and brothers in Christ. But the wisdom from above is good. In verse 16, he continues to deal with this whole piece of earthly wisdom. He says in verse 16, "For where you have envy and selfish ambitions, there you will find disorder and evil practices." This wisdom does not foster, in other words, this wisdom does not foster healthy relationships. Everything that we do as believers in Christ Jesus, every single person in the world will put on earth to have relationships, to be in relationships with one another, to be in relationship with God, even if we deny the fact that there is a God in heaven. All of us were created to be in relationship with one another. And so James says, this kind of wisdom, this earthly wisdom, this envy and selfish ambition, this wisdom does not promote healthy relationships. The Bible says God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. And so as Christians, we ought to be looking for, we ought to be making every effort to demonstrate wisdom from above. Here is what James continues to say to us in verse 17. But the wisdom that comes from above, the wisdom that comes from heaven, is first of all pure, and then peace-loving, considerate, and submissive, full of mercy and good fruit, impartial and sincere. Peacemakers, he says in verse 18, who sows in peace reap a harvest of righteousness. Wisdom from above, my sisters and brothers in Christ. In other words, it fosters healthy relationships. James addresses several problems that is happening in the church. He addresses, if you remember in chapter 2, he addresses discrimination in the church. He gave an example of a rich man and a poor man, and one in rich clothes and fine clothes and one in filthy clothes, if you remember. He also addresses the tongue in the church. He's writing to the church. He's writing to Christians, to brothers and sisters, because we saw in the opening chapters, he said to the 12 tribes who are scattered abroad. And he also addresses now fights and quarrels. In chapter 4 and verse 1, he says this, where does fights and quarrels among you come from? That's a question. And he says, hey, let me tell you where they come from. Do they not come from your desire to battle within? Within all of us, my sisters and brothers in Christ, there is a fight. Within all of us, there is something that is trying to gain control. And James says that fight within us, unless we yield that fight to God, unless we yield that fight within us to the Father above and allow Jesus to transform our lives, James says we will continue to have issues in the church. I can't tell you the number of pastors that I have conversation with, my sisters and brothers in Christ, who are going through, right in their own church. They're not going through with causation from the world. They're going through a whole bunch of difficulties right inside their own churches, right inside the churches that they have been called to lead. And James says he knows what the problem is. He knows where the fights come from. He says in verse 2, you desire but do not have, so you kill. You covet but cannot get what you want, so you quarrel and fight. And then he says this, you do not have because you do not ask God. James helps us this morning in attaining this wisdom that comes from above. He says the wisdom that comes from above is attainable. Every single one of us are able to grasp that wisdom that comes from above and apply it in our lives. I can name you several churches in our district, on our district, that are having issues. And if anyone would sit back and ask, Jesus, what do you want me to do with your church? Jesus, how do you want me to handle your church? Jesus, what is the meaning of church? The church belongs to Jesus Christ, according to Colossians. It says, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning of the first fruit among the dead, so that in everything he might have supremacy. James says this in the third verse of chapter 4. When you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasure. What James sees and presents to the church is a vicious cycle. Unless we allow the wisdom from above, unless we intentionally apply God's word into our everyday lives, James says we continue in this vicious cycle of beating one another up, of causing one another's issues. Now, he says this, he uses this exaggeration to get our attention of how important it is to apply God's word, how important it is to use the wisdom that comes from above in everyday living. That's his point. In verse 7 of chapter 4 and 8, as we finish this piece, he says this. Here is how it takes place. Here is the good news. He says, submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Submit yourselves to God. Submit, in this particular instance, my sisters and brothers in Christ, it means to place in rank order of, or to give in to. Or in other words, it means to repent. James, my sisters and brothers in Christ, helps us to understand that godly wisdom is such a something that we can live into, something that we can have, something that we can be transformed by. Godly wisdom, my sisters and brothers in Christ, James helps us to know that we could transform the world with godly living. He says this, and this is what I love about James in verse 8. And gives us this prescription. He says, come near to God and he will come near to you. Wash your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. He says, come near to God and he will come near to you, because God wants to be in relationship with us, my sisters and brothers in Christ. The God of the universe wants to be in relationship with each one of us. And James says, this is how it's done. Come near to God and God will come near to you. You make the first step and God will make two. That's what he's saying. The word come near to God And this application means to be squeezed, or to squeeze, or to come close to. And so James is reminding us this morning that God wants to squeeze us. God wants to hold us. God wants to come close to us if we apply the wisdom from above. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. A hymn of praise, my sisters and brothers in Christ. It comes from a familiar place, and I love this hymn. And I probably say it about all of the United Methodist hymns because I'm United Methodist through and through. It comes from hymn number 354, I Surrender All. Will you sing with me? Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. I love that hymn, I Surrender All. It is one of those submissive songs that James talks about. Submit yourselves to God. I love verse 4. Verse 4 says this, all to Jesus I surrender. Lord, I give myself to thee. Fill me with thy love and power. Let thy blessings fall on me. Our affirmation of faith, my sisters and brothers in Christ, is found on page 885, and our hymnal is printed here for your reading. Let us engage in our affirmation. Let us affirm our faith. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is one true church, apostolic and universal, whose holy faith let us now declare. We believe in God the Father, infinite in wisdom and power and love, whose mercy is over all his works, and whose will is ever directed to his children's good. We believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God and Son of Man, the gift of the Father's unfailing grace, the ground of our hope and the promise of our deliverance from sin and death. We believe in the Holy Spirit as the divine presence in our lives, whereby we are kept in perpetual remembrance of the truth of Christ, and we find strength to help in a time of need. We believe that this faith should manifest itself in service of love, in the service of love as set forth as the example by our blessed Lord, to the end that the kingdom of God may come upon the earth. Amen. Our offering, my sisters and brothers in Christ, and we are overjoyed of the fact that the Lord gives to us, that we may be a blessing, that we may give back to God. We're not giving God to get something, we're giving because we're being obedient to God and God's leading. I believe this, the Bible says that God loves a cheerful giver. So we give not out of compulsion, not out of the fact that someone is commanding or making us give, we give because we love to give. The Bible submits to us as more blessed to give than to receive. And so you can share your gifts of tithes and offerings with us here at Trinity United Methodist Church by way of going to our website at Trinity King George, Virginia, and you will find a link that will help you to give electronically. Or you may mail your gifts of tithes and offerings to us here at Trinity United Methodist Church in P.O. Box 155, King George, Virginia, 22485. Amen. Will you join with me in our doxology as we praise God? Our joys and concerns, my sisters and brothers in Christ, and we share in joys and concerns each week because we believe that God is actively working in and through our lives and that we ought to know what God is doing in each other's lives. And so if God is blessing you, we'd love to hear from you. Share what God is actively doing in and through your life by reaching us here at Trinity United Methodist Church in King George, Virginia. If you go to our website, you'll find a link where you can write to us. Or you can write directly to me as the pastor of this place. You can write directly by tagging me at kevinelmore@vaumc.org, and I'll absolutely respond. Amen? Might we pray? Gracious God, you treat us in ways that is absolutely because of your character. You bless us because your word says that you are love. Your very nature, the character that you display is love. And so God, you said to us that we are able to display that same love to the world around us. We're able to display that same love to one another, that agape love, because we love for no reason. And so, God, we are grateful today that we're able to come and we're able to love on one another. We're able to share gifts with one another. We're able to pray for one another. And so we lift up whatever concern, whatever need is happening in and through our lives. God, we ask that you would continue to be with us, continue to use us, continue to grow us, continue to have your way in each of our lives. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and give you glory. We pray this prayer that unites our hearts and our minds together that you've given us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing prayer, my sisters and brothers in Christ, we simply want to bless you. We believe this, that God shared this with Moses and Aaron. God told Moses to say to Aaron to bless the people. And Aaron did that, and he blessed us with this benediction and closing prayer. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you, and may the Lord lift up his countenance unto you and give you peace. Amen. Amen.